All right. We will be playing special music this morning, and this little group is called Grace Note. And so obviously, as some of the musicians probably already identified, it has a double meaning. Obviously, we wanted it to be something that can glorify God. A little group put together by students to do little things here and there just because we love music and we love the Lord. And the other meaning of grace note is obviously a musical term of a note that is placed before the actual note, kind of added in artistically. And that kind of reflects of what this group also stands for is freedom to interpret songs in a little different or new way, but also portray the message of a song. Maybe in a way that you might have not heard before. And so 2 years ago, a few of us got together and we're like, let's make this happen. And so it's been a journey that is slowly coming to an end for me, but I believe they will keep going once I graduate. And it's something that stands I want to encourage you with this to do what you love and serve the Lord with it. All right? And, of course, we'll be playing. So please meditate upon how you can praise the Lord this morning for the things he has done for you, as this is a wonderful praise hymn.
Good morning. Some of you will recognize that I am the men's dean, the residence hall dean, and what is he doing up there? Well, I wasn't always the residence hall dean. I came here to be a student, and things just happened. As I start this morning, I'd like to share a verse with you. It comes from Psalms 145, verse 8, and this is what it says. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to anger, and great mercy. This has been the story of God's working in my life. God has been good to me. I think we could all say that. Amen? And so it's fitting this morning that I share a little bit of my journey with you on how I arrived at Weimar Institute. I came here actually in August of 2012 to go through the AVCO program, which at that time was on the campus, and it was the last time that the program was held here at Weimar Institute. And so coming here was actually an answer to prayer. I had been working at my local church, and I'd been praying and asking the Lord to help me find something that I could get more involved in, a ministry outside the church. We were doing all the things that churches are supposed to do. We were doing outreach and evangelistic series and reaching out to the neighborhood around us, but I felt like I wanted to be more involved in a bigger way. And so the Lord got me involved in Army Ministries. And has anybody been to Army Bible Camp? Army Bible Camp, yes. I was there. I went there through an answer to prayer, which I don't have time to go into this morning. My time is a little bit limited. I tried to explain to Ashley that since I'm three times as old as the rest of the students, I should get three times the time to speak this morning, and she just looked at me and smiled. So I realized that was a no. So I was involved at my home church. I got involved with Army Ministries, and I began to work with Calvin Kim and Dave Stewart, who are both good friends of mine. And Dave told me about AVCO, and I thought, great. I was working for the Sheriff's Department down in Ventura County at the time, and I thought, when I retire, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to AVCO. And so I came here, and I went through the AVCO program. And after that, we went on a mission trip to India for 3 weeks, and that was amazing. And while I was in India, I was trying to decide what I was going to do, and my stuff was already here, and I always wanted to take some theology classes, so I thought, well, I'll stay a semester and take a few classes. So I stayed the first semester, and I'll tell you what, the devil really tried to get me to leave. I didn't fit in with the faculty, because I'm even older than some of the faculty members, probably most of the faculty members. And I didn't fit in with the students at all. They were like, what's this old guy doing in our classes? It was really hard the first 3 or 4 months. And I remember one day I was walking back to the dorm, and you know, the devil's like, you could be in Southern California, and you could be with your friends, and you could be enjoying being retired and this and that. And it was by Princess Dorm, and it was very cold that day, and it was a little bit windy, and I put my head down, and I said, nope, I'm going to stay here. The Lord wants me to be here, and that's what I'm going to do. And by the time I got to the front door of Hillside, where I was living at the time, I had peace. And so I knew that the Lord wanted me here. I'd like to explain why he wanted me here, but it'll take too long to go into that. But, you know, having worked in law enforcement, I was a patrol sergeant, I was a sergeant in detectives, and you have people working under you, and you go to these scenes, and you bring order from chaos, and it tends to bring some pride, and some people need to listen to what I'm telling them, because at work, that's exactly what they do. And the Lord needed to work this out of me. And so he said, okay, I'll get you to Weimar. And then after the first couple of months, I went on a mission trip to Lebanon, and it was amazing. And I really clicked with the students on the mission trip, which was a blessing, because the next summer, the guy that had been dean, Kevin Doe, he's the pastor of the Meadow Vista and Colfax Church now, he left. And so Skip Dodson called me and said, hey, we're looking for a men's dean. Would you be interested? And I said, sure, why not? And so we worked out the details, and I came back the next semester, and I was the men's dean, and they agreed to let me continue taking classes, and so I'm here today because I'm finishing this weekend, praise the Lord. Erwin was in classes with me. It was a blessing. But the lesson that I learned is that I'm now going to put you in charge of young people. They're not going to listen to you like everyone else did. They're going to do their own thing. You need to learn some patience, and you need to learn some humility. I have endeavored to do that, but it has been a long journey. And I pray, my wife and I, every night we pray for the campus, we pray for the people here, and I pray that you would pray for me as I continue this journey, that the Lord leads me where it is that he wants me to go. Now, everyone's asking me, and so I'm going to tell you all at the same time, I have no plans to leave right now. I will be here for a while. If the Lord works it out, not this next school year, but the following school year, my daughter and my son-in-law will be here. And my son-in-law, and he intends to take theology. And that means my grandkids will be here, so it'd be kind of silly to leave when my some of my favorite people in the whole world will be here. So God bless each one of you. Thank you for coming this weekend. It means a lot to us that you share this milestone in our lives with us. God bless you all.
How can I say thanks for the things you have done for me? Things so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. How well I remember that first day of school here at Weimar some 5.5 years ago. Being truly gripped with fear as I entered Dr. Harris's survey of chemistry class, I wondered if I was really ready for this experience. Would I understand the material? Could I keep up with the assignments? Would I make new friends? Etc., etc. This memorable first day of school was the beginning of an amazing journey that would bring me all the way to this incredible graduation weekend. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. This promise pretty much sums up what I've been learning to do throughout my time here. The famed question I was asked more than any other was, what are you taking in college? With very little confidence, I would answer that I didn't know yet, but I hoped to figure it out soon. In those early years, I remember quite literally poring over websites of various universities to see if a particular degree would catch my eye. I would discuss my strengths and weaknesses and personal interests with my parents and others who knew me, while also pondering the degree paths of other students, wondering if perhaps this might be a good fit for me too. However, too often I would try to figure things out on my own, without really putting my trust in God and his plan for me. I didn't know how to truly trust in God, and it seemed like every time I tried to plan out my life, I was left defeated and discouraged. I was amazed at those around me who seemed to have everything all figured out, but me? Slowly, God was teaching me what it meant to trust in him. Instead of trying to do things on my own, I realized that trusting God meant letting go of myself and my plans and patiently waiting for him to reveal the next step to me. I realized that it was okay for me to not know every step that God has for me, but that I had to simply take life and my future one day at a time. I realized that instead of worrying about my future, I could happily trust in each step that God has promised to lead me through. As I was finishing my first 2 years of core classes, I knew that a more definite academic plan was needed as I moved forward with my education. I began taking some online business classes from Andrews while asking God to help me trust in his plan for my future that I could not see. I know that it is no coincidence that around this time, I learned that Weimar was prayerfully exploring the possibility of offering a business degree. My faith was strengthened as I witnessed the miracles begin to unfold and the prayers being answered as the business program became a reality. I knew this was the direction God was leading me in, and I am so thankful that I was able to remain here at Weimar to complete my business degree. Not only has this degree practically prepared me for my future career, But other activities, such as TCI, has helped me to learn to set aside my business and be about my Father's business. What a rich blessing has been mine to study this degree path, where service to God is interwoven throughout my classes, and seeking to please and honor God in all my business dealings is emphasized over success in a worldly sense. God has been faithful to me. Without him, I wouldn't be standing here today. He has not failed me even once. He has taught me and is still continuing to teach me what it means to trust him wholly and completely with everything. I'm looking forward to seeing how God will continue to lead me in the coming years. And as I close, once again, the final words to that familiar song seem fitting. To God be the glory, to God be the glory, to God be the glory for the things he has done.
Good morning. So my reasons for coming to Weimar was, when I first came was because I was trying to escape bad grades. The other one was because I want to learn of medical ministry, medical missionary work. Someone had gave me the book Medical Ministry, and so in reading that, I was still undergoing some conflict with what to do and whether I want to really do that or do music or something else. So first year when I came here, it went relatively well, and then the second year my bad habits kind of caught up with me. You can't really run away from them when your bad habits are part of you. So second semester is when I was really faced with these things. My grades started to go bad. They weren't extremely bad, but they were pretty bad, and well, I guess, anyhow. So the only hope that I had was, I had heard other stories of people being transformed by reading the Bible, and that was what I had a hope for, is that others, in reading the Bible, they were changed, like the island of Pitcairn, and so that's what I hoped for myself, too. I'm really thankful to Weimar for its spiritual influences. Community college is a little different than that. They don't have spiritual influence, of course. And if they do, well, you kind of want to stay away from it. So, I don't know the extent of the influence, but it was significant. And here, when I had these habits, there wasn't really anyone that I wanted to turn to. I imagine there are probably maybe some, but when you have bad habits, it's kind of embarrassing, and at least I don't know that friendships were deep enough to share those. So when I started reading the Bible, I really wanted to know God. I really wanted to know how do I overcome these things. And these verses came to mind when I was studying. I chose Romans because I had read the Bible through, and Romans was like, Paul was so confusing. I was like, I don't understand. Like. And so I just read him through, but like it wasn't making sense. And so that's how I started reading. I started Romans. And this is the verses that came to mind as I was studying. I really wanted to know. It says, "Ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart." And then another one that came to mind. It says, "But without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him." And so throughout that, I was really studying, wanting to know. And for anyone who is struggling, I would encourage you to read Romans and really search the Bible. If you want to know God, he will find you. And he did find me, at least. So then other verses came to mind as I was studying. I was probably through a couple chapters of it. I hadn't gotten to the Romans 8 part where it talks about this. But Psalms 51 came to mind where it says, "Create me a clean heart." And I learned that I can't do it on my own. I can't, through all the mental exercises, trying to develop algorithms to stop myself. It doesn't work that way. And the other one is like, "How do I know I saved?" And John 3:16 came to mind. And And so that summer I was rebaptized. I'm really thankful to teachers and to those who've been in my life. There's a lot of things that I've had to learn. And I still have a lot of ways to go, as do I trust we all do, but anyhow. I'm trusting in him to keep me because I don't know what the future is. And through his grace, I trust to finish the race. And so the verses that also fits, I guess, is, "Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it." And I wish for others to know, even though wherever we are, it's not about the future, it's about where we are and those around us, that they may be struggling with things that we don't know, and that they could use some of that good news. They could use some of that help that only Christ can give.
Many, O Lord, are your wonderful works which you have done, and your thoughts toward us cannot be recounted in order. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. That is truly what I've experienced when I came to Weimar. When I first came, I stepped into my dorm, saw the dirty carpet, the dirty walls, the almost brown lawn. I was like, I'm supposed to stay here for 4 months. I was like, I don't think I'll make it. I just wanted to leave. And I was quite sad. And a few days later, it started to get better. And then I graduated from health. And now I'm graduating from pre-med. And it's been 4 years. And I'm like, Weimar isn't all that bad. Now I'm sad having to leave. What happened? Anyway, so while I was in health, it was about October, I decided I'd go and figure out what God wants me to do after health. And so I went into the woods, took my Bible, and I spent a whole morning out praying and studying the Bible, and the only text I could find is, "Lots of study is weary to the flesh," which is true, I have to say. And I chose a career path or a area of study where you'll have to study till you're, I don't know, 90s, whatever, I don't know. But I also heard God's reassuring voice that he would help me study if that's what I wanted to do, and if I was going to accept the call that he had for me. So I heard the call to become a medical missionary. I figured out that medicine is really something that I could do. But I realized that I didn't want to help people become healthy and just live longer to have more opportunities to do evil. Because then you wouldn't actually be doing anything good if you're helping people live longer to do bad things. Right? All right. So that's when I realized that medical missionary work or medical work must be done together with spiritual work. And once I realized that God was calling me into pre-med, I went and checked my wallet. I looked, and I was missing $80,000. But I realized they had never been there before, so yeah, that was a little bit of a problem. But when God calls you to do something, he'll provide a way. And thanks to God's miracles and some wonderful people, some of which are actually in this room, I have been able to complete my studies here without debt. And that was something that I told God, I will pursue these studies if you pay for it, because I'm not going to take out any loans. Now, going to Loma Linda, I checked into it. I actually can't get any loans. So big thing? No. But God took care of it. So even if I wanted to, I couldn't have. So God opened those doors, and I'm very thankful. So I'll tell you a little bit about this sponsorship that I got. So after I went out in the woods and prayed about it, I figured out that I would need a sponsor. So I prayed for it about 3 weeks. And then Pastor Don comes walking down the aisle and Granny bade to me before one of the health talks that I was about to give. He's like, hey, so there's an anonymous donor that wants to support you going through school, 75%. He'll pay 75%. I was like, praise the Lord, after 3 weeks of praying. So I was extremely thankful. So I go on my Christmas break to Texas with a wonderful family that adopted me. And yeah, the Schmidt family. And then I came back and I went through registration. There were different tables in this room and we were checking off papers. And I was like, okay, so Mrs. Hess, the $3,000 down payment, I think my sponsor can take care of that. And I'll pay the rest later, you know, when I get a summer job or something. And so she's like, why don't you check with Pastor Don real quick? Just make sure that, you know, your sponsor is all set up. So I go over to him and he's like, oh, I forgot to tell you, 2 days ago, your sponsor actually dropped out. And I was like, oh, no, but he didn't leave me hanging. He's like, the next day I emailed some of my friends and I got a sponsor within 1 day. And he actually paid almost 100%. So it was even better. And all that was happening while I was just sure that I was going to walk straight into school. And God worked out right behind the scenes everything I needed to do. Well, I could talk all morning, but another experience that I had here was the verse, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and everything will be added unto you. So one day I sat down and I realized that my life as a Christian wasn't that different from a secular student, because I was studying my books about, you know, 10 to 15 minutes. No, I'm just kidding. About 1 to 2 to 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hours a day, depending on what time of the semester it was. and so I realized that I'm not that different. So I was like, well, a true Christian who really wants to experience change in their life would spend a little more time than just 10 minutes in the Bible, right? And so I said, okay, if I seek God first, maybe he'll add in everything unto me. Does it apply to students too? Yes, it does. Okay? And so I ended up changing my devotions from 10 minutes to 2 hours, where I spent an hour reading and an hour praying, and it was the best decision I've ever made in my life. You obviously have to cut back on the time you spend studying, because there's only so much time in the day. And so I ended up getting actually a 4.0 that semester for the very first time, which is a witness to God's glory, because I studied less, but God really did add everything that I needed, as he promised, because I was seeking him first.
Send me raw wood, and I will give you back arrows. This is a famous phrase of John Calvin. This means that in his Bible schools in Geneva, he would train people from all over Europe to become missionaries for Christ in their own countries. Similar concept can be found, not exactly the same, in Psalm 127, verse 3 and 4. Lo, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. As arrows are in the hand of the mighty man, so are children of the youth. This has been my experience at the Weimar Institute for 4.5 years. When I first came to Weimar Institute in August 2014, I did not have much knowledge about the Bible. I grew up in a non-religious family in Japan and came to the United States for college education. At first, I was going to one of the community colleges in Bay Area and planning to transfer to one of the UC schools in order to study philosophy. My purpose of studying philosophy was to define my life, find the purpose of my life, and to determine what I would like to do in the future. But this plan was changed when my next door neighbor in San Jose invited me to the Mountain View Japanese Seventh Adventist Church, which I am being a Bible worker for right now. As I started to study the Bible, all the questions that I had in my life were answered. Therefore, I thought I did not have to study philosophy anymore. Because I think the best philosophy, if I put it this way, is can be found in the Bible, right? Then I told one of the pastors in Mount Tibu Japanese Seventh Adventist Church that I was looking for a SDA institutions to study theology. Then he suggested me three institutions: Andrews University, Southern Adventist University, and Weimar Institute. Of those three, he encouraged me to go to Weimar Institute because he told me that it's more family-like, it's much smaller than other universities, so everyone knows each other. So I decided to come over here for visitation. When I visited here, that was March 2014. When I visited here for the first time, I saw the difference from other universities. Like the pastor said, the campus was more like a village than a typical crowded college campus. Everybody knew each other. Teachers and students put God first above anything, because I was looking for something different from typical education in the world. I decided to come to Weimar Institute. Even though I was convicted to apply for Weimar Institute, I was still not sure about when to come. Maybe after I finish community college. Maybe after I finish one more quarter in the community college. But I was impressed to apply immediately for fall 2014. So I visited here again in July 2014. This time it was actually a few days before I was baptized in Monterey Bay Ocean. I chose that location because Jesus was baptized in the river, so I thought it would be nice if I got baptized in nature. Then I became sure that I should come here for fall 2014. And I was still skeptical still about how I would be accepted on time, as the semester would begin within 1 month. But God opened the door for me, and I was able to make it for fall 2014 after all the paperwork was submitted and I received the acceptance letter. I was very excited to study the Bible as I started life at Weimar, but soon I went through trials. I realized that I was one of the few students who did not know much about the Bible. While everyone could draw some important lessons from the Bible stories, I was not even familiar with those stories. I also had a hard time reading writings of Ellen G. White because her English is a little bit archaic. I encountered many unfamiliar words, which made it hard for me to understand what she meant. I still remember that I was failing life and teaching of Christ in my very first semester. When the instructor, back then, Pastor Rich Constantinescu, he was an instructor of LTJ, he realized I was struggling with this class, and he took a walk with me and gave me a word of encouragement. Since then, my grades started to improve little by little, and it finally became A. But not only that, I was also able to understand how God cared about me through my instructor, Pastor Rich Constantinescu, and also the chapters I read from the Desire of Ages, how Jesus reached out to people who were neglected in the society back then. Over the four and a half years, God has given me knowledge and wisdom day by day. What I really appreciate Weimar Institute for as I spent 4.5 years is that fact that there are some opportunities for theology students to learn about health and medical missionary. I had a chance to shadow Pastor Don in depression and anxiety recovery program. And one thing I learned from this program was that reason for depression is usually, not always, but usually related to relational issues. What I mean by that is it's usually something has to do with those who are around you, maybe family, maybe friends. Since sin entered into this world, we're no longer bearing the image of God perfectly, and it had become hard for us to have good relationship with each other. But I think the solution is to look at Christ. When you look at Christ, we try to bear his image, and our relationship with others can get better as well. Lastly, I would like to express gratitude to all of you who had helped me to come closer to Christ. and I would like to encourage all of you to think of how you can help fellow brothers and sisters to know Christ more.
If I were to point out two experiences in my life that shaped me the most, the first would be my year in the Philippines as a student missionary, and the second would be my experience at Weimar College. The interesting thing about these two experiences is that I did both of them for the wrong reasons. I went to the Philippines not because I wanted to serve, but because I was in a relationship that shouldn't have happened in the first place, and I knew that the only way I can escape from it is to leave the country. On the other hand, I came to Weimar to escape what God was calling me to do at that time. You see, I've always wanted to become a businessman. I wanted to be filthy rich. And so when I felt that God was calling me into the ministry at that time, I did not want to do it. And so between business and the ministry, I decided medicine, where I could make what a businessman would make while also serving others as a doctor. And so I decided to come to Weimar to pursue pre-med and to be as close to God as possible while not wanting to fully surrender my love for money and status. What a wrong place to try to do that. Because between each dorm worship, corporate worship, conversations with friends, small group worships, class worships, God was constantly knocking on my heart, and I continued to resist. And it was not until I saw before my eyes a demonstration of the great controversy that I finally fully surrendered. I thought I was surrendering a career at that time, but I was wrong. What really had to go was self, pride. Self wanted the status. Self wanted to be looked up to. Self wanted the security that came with knowing that you have done better than others. Self wanted the admiration of others. Self was the true problem. It does not really matter what career path you choose. It's your purpose for doing it that matters. If self is at the center of what you do, your good works is abhorrent to God. Self had to die. If self dies and Christ lives within us, our low self-confidence will be turned into Christ's confidence. Our low self-esteem into Christ's esteem, and our low self-worth into Christ's worth. Amen. Through all these experiences, my passion for the medical missionary work never changed. My passion for the medical mission work was ignited when I responded to an altar call to be a medical missionary at a camp meeting at the young age of 10. And although at times that passion has been forgotten, it has never left me. And my experience at Weimar has only strengthened that passion, especially when you see a patient at New Start getting off 13 different medications, when you see how he chokes up with tears in his eyes because of his before and after lab results, when he realizes how much God loves him because of the healing power of God, and when because of all of these, he decides to fully surrender himself to God. When you see the patient at depression recovery program surrendering what self is holding on to, that is literally killing them, and accepting what Christ has done, the hope of salvation. And so when I gave up medicine, I thought I was giving up the medical missionary work too. I was wrong. Sometimes God has to lead you into the wilderness before he can lead you into Canaan, just as he did to the Israelites. Sometimes he has to lead you out of Egypt before leading you back into it. Like Moses. Sometimes he has to demand the sacrifice of Isaac before giving Isaac back to you. Maybe he had to take away my passion for the medical missionary work combined with all the complications of self attached to it before he can make me a true medical missionary. I'm not yet fully sure of what his plans are for me, but I have experienced how he has pieced my wrong reasons together for good, and the best is yet to come. I know that he can do the same for you too. And so I learned the most important lesson at Weimar, that self has to die. and Christ has to live within me. If self dies, I would not have any problems. It would all be God's problems, not mine. Before I end, I would like to give myself a word of advice. Remember that the goal and the purpose is the soul. Keep that goal and purpose before you. Keep Christ within you. Keep self behind you, and you'll never go wrong. Set your affection on things above, not on things on earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God.
Well, Chen-Zen, I kind of have an idea of what the next steps are, if you want to talk with me. It's not like we've never talked about this before. Well, this morning, as we looked at the schedule for the weekend, we realized that graduation is in the context of a church here, and so I wanted to not forget those of you among us who are actually new in the faith here. As we heard last night in the consecration message, we often sometimes forget the really purpose that we're here. So let's just bow our heads and spend a couple moments thinking about this purpose. Father in heaven, Lord, thank you for these testimonies that really are only possible because of the life you give us. And bless us as we spend a few moments here concerning or in your word and concerning your church. In Christ's name, amen. Harvard University has a seal, just like we do, that says Veritas Christo et Ecclesia, or Truth for Christ and the Church. This was their original seal. But somewhere along on the line, they decided to change their seal to just truth. Truth not for church, but just truth. And they kind of lost the focus of what truth really is. And so, like many universities today, people that go to school lose their faith. Only 20% of students who are highly churched as teens remain spiritually active by age 29. The number of students who frequently attend religious services drops by 23% after 3 years in college. 36% rate their spirituality lower after 3 years in college. And comparing responses of freshmen who said they were born again with seniors, there was a 59% drop in those claiming that. But I'm thankful that every testimony we've heard so far here today is strangely different than that. And I'm thankful that our seal is a little different as well. Led by Matthew 9:35, Jesus went about doing good and healing all manner of sickness and disease among the people, with those three trumpets indicating the three angels' messages, with that leaf, the right hand of the gospel, with that church coming to the world and uplifting the cross as people do well with their work and their academics. And instead of a crown like you would see today, there is a crown of thorns, but then a laurel wreath of victory promised after sacrifice. So the board of directors, when a few years back, they made a decision. Up until this time, there had never been a church on campus, and actually a number of students were losing their way by attending other churches not so far from here, not a million miles from here. So there was a conscious decision to educate students in medical missionary lines in connection with the church and with the ministry. Now, this is always messy because it's hard to work in a church with ministry, as we heard last night. But that should not be unexpected. That should be actually something we expect. And that should be not something that we decry, but something that we glory in, because in the church is where we're able to work through those things. Strength to resist evil is best gained by aggressive service. And when I first came to this campus, there was no aggressive service, really, of any magnitude. But that has changed. And I have seen amazing things happen in the lives of students and faculty and also my own life. Nicodemus was a very highly educated individual, high position. He was wealthy. He was a strict Pharisee. He was filled with great pride. And we're told by the pen of inspiration, he had a false security of the favor of God. And he was interested only in temporal success. He was a well-loved teacher. If you would take a vote, he would probably be the best-loved teacher. In the estimation of his students, his life had been just and honorable. And yet he realized that he was bankrupt. He struggled with pride. Even though he was a religious instructor, he had a vacuous experience. But somehow he was drawn to Christ. And he said to him, "No one can do these signs that you do unless God is in him." He saw Christ's medical missionary work. He saw his physical acts of healing. He saw his emotional care for people and his involvement. I doubt very much that there would have ever been a class like we have today if Christ was our teacher. All of our time would have been spent in the community, on the job, in training. And I doubt we would have ever sat behind a desk, ever. Nicodemus was gripped by these things, but there was a controversy. You see, he had witnessed Christ's wonderful works, and this had brought conviction to him as a member of the Sanhedrin. But others around tried to silence him because of the marvelous works. If I told you the behind-the-scenes stories of what happened even here at Weimar to try and get just one day or half a day focusing on involvement in the community, it would be surprising, perhaps shocking to you. And it was a fight, and it will always be a fight. And let me just say, I believe it will continue to be a fight in your life, because other things will always try to come in to take away from the real focus, which is to seek and save that which is lost, not only outside, but also the coins that may be lost inside. And when you share with others, you not only help them, we're told in 1 Timothy 4, but you save your own soul. Now, what did he need to do to move forward? He did not need to give a sermon on pride and how terrible it was. He needed to recognize his own pride. And Jesus said to him, "You must be born again of water and of the Spirit, or you will not enter the kingdom of God." Now, he realized that the Baptist was talking about pride, and he was startled, however, to think that maybe this message of being born again of water baptism in the Spirit could apply to him. He knew that Christ was referring to water baptism and the renewing of the heart by the Spirit of God. He knew that. That's what the pen of inspiration shows us. In fact, he probably had been baptized, in fact was, in mikvah baths many, many times. And here's a picture of one of those ancient baths. So had most of all the other leaders. But here he's being asked to be baptized again. Rebaptism was being appealed for in his life. All who have sins to wash away, all who live has sins to wash away. True repentance of sin, faith in the merits of Jesus Christ, and baptism into his death to be raised out of the water to live a new life are the very first steps in the new birth which Christ told Nicodemus he must experience in order to be saved. The words of Christ to Nicodemus are not only spoken to him, but every man, woman, and child that should live in the world. We are safe only in following the example of Christ. In the message to the church in Ephesus, we're told that they had lost their first love. But I found it surprisingly fascinating to trace out what the steps were to actually go forward from losing that first love experience. They're actually the same steps given to Laodicea. I know your works. Laodicea is the last in the seven churches, the one that most aptly fits the Advent movement. I know your works. You're neither cold nor hot. I wish you were cold or hot. So then, because you're lukewarm and neither cold or hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Because you say I'm rich and have become wealthy and have need of nothing and do not know that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. You know, the Adventist Church has had, started in 1863, and it's had some ups and downs. One of them was in the year 1888. There was a conference and people had the wrong spirit with one another concerning doctrine. And notice these words that were penned. Have not many in this ministerial institute seen their mistake of not abiding in Christ? Cannot they have the privilege of repenting and doing the first works? Well, what are the first works? He's alluding directly to the message to those in Ephesus. Who shall condemn this work of repentance and of confession and of what? Baptism. Some consciously feel that their first duty is to repent of their sins, confess them, and be baptized. Is not this the first works that they must do? And then she quotes the passage, actually, from Revelation. This is not the first time she says that. That's after a church council. They all were together studying the Bible. They all were together focusing in on God's word. And they needed to be rebaptized as a result of how they were doing that, trying to bring division, undercutting one another, and they needed to confess their pride and be rebaptized. But this happens also in sanitarium settings. Notice, fast forward to 1903. I speak to our leading brethren, to our ministers, especially our physicians. As long as you allow your pride to dwell in your hearts, so long will you lack power in your work. For years a wrong spirit has been cherished, a spirit of pride, a desire for preeminence. And this Satan is served, God is dishonored. And the Lord calls for a decided reformation. And when a soul is truly reconverted, let him be rebaptized. Who is this talking to? Brethren, ministers, we could add in their teachers, and physicians. My brethren, show true repentance for departure from God. You see, it's not enough to talk about these things. There must be action if there's been wrongdoing. We may make mistakes, 1906. We may have to admonish mother. This is a church in Oakland, California that was backbiting, going beyond admonishment. But there have come into the churches of Oakland and the surrounding community a spirit of backbiting, fault finding, evil speaking, which demonstrate that you are not converted. So what needed to happen in this local church? As transformation of character takes place through repentance and confession and reconversion and rebaptism, you will glory through Christ in those things which pertain to God, not in the things that pertain to your own personal selfish interests. When I read these quotes a number of years ago, 2 years ago to be exact, I felt deeply convicted. Not only because I was a teacher here and still am, and a pastor, but because of my own relationship and my own family, and also my relationships here. I needed to recommit my life. And so I did. I asked Pastor Gilly to baptize me in the Jordan River. And there was a change in my life. Not just because of the water, but because I sincerely wanted to recommit my life to God. That began a ripple effect. Other people were baptized as a result of that. There was more strength that I saw in my co-laboring with Dr. Nedley. He also was rebaptized in the Jordan River. And we've seen God powerfully work in the depression recovery programs in an amazing way. Not only that, as one of our chaplains listened to that message, he also decided to be rebaptized. He wrote a series, a fresh new series on the gospel, and that has borne fruit as well in this place and many other places. So we have at least some of the leading brethren here that were convicted, and even among the physicians, there were those that said, I too, our medical director, Dr. Galan, also said, I too desire to be rebaptized and made that commitment. And the ripple effect has included others. Just last week, or the week before rather, Nita Young was baptized, and I was privileged to sit with her this week in a group that meets, celebrating recovery, an addiction group. She could not help herself, and she was sharing her testimony with others. And I thought, how wonderful that the leading brethren led the way in admitting that they need the Lord and were rebaptized. You know, I want to call up just a couple people now in the last 7 minutes of my time with you, because there are people right now that are making decisions. And one of the reasons that we carved out this time is because we don't want to have a week go by where we're not allowing people to continue on to know the Lord. And so some of the people we've studied with, even on our TCI group, and I'd like to call up Nathan and Annalise and Christian, some of the people that we studied with, were really making moves, and also Henry and Christina Escamilla and the Academy were involved in this, but just as they were making decisions to accept the Lord and come and be baptized, and one of those mics, they had their kidneys shut down and suddenly died. And one of these was Donna. And maybe you guys want to tell us a little about your studies with Donna and what you felt about her as a person and what God was doing in her life.
So the first time I met Donna, I don't know if this thing's working.
It's working, great. So the first time I met Donna, she was actually visiting a Sabbath school class here, the Sabbath school class that Greg Lundquist teaches. And I met her in Sabbath school there, and she had a lot of questions about the Bible. And so we discussed during Sabbath school a little bit afterwards, and she kept coming back. And one week I was teaching the Sabbath school for Mr. Lundquist, and after Sabbath school, we stayed for maybe 45 minutes discussing different questions she had about the Bible. And she said, hey, can you come over, you know, with some of your friends every week and study with me? And I was like, absolutely. Why not? So I went over and studied with her. I invited Christian and Annalise. And the three of us would go over, would study with her every Wednesday. It was a huge blessing. And what was so cool about studying with her in particular was how open she was. She was incredibly open and incredibly sincere. She really wanted to be right with God. She really didn't know that her time was close, I don't think. But there was something telling her, you need to be right with God. Mm-hmm. And that was amazing. Do you have anything you want to add?
Yeah, so Donna was...
It's on now.
Donna was one of the contacts that we had been studying with. She wasn't our main contact, if I can say that. but we would always just go to her house every week, just for an hour. And during that 1 hour time period, she would just be, like Nathan said, she was very open. She was a very real person. She didn't care that you knew that she was struggling, if that makes sense. I think a lot of us try to hide the fact that we're human, and we try to say things or do things or be a type of person that people would like us to see. But she was very real. She was open. She was honest about what she was struggling with, what she was feeling. And she knew that she was on a walk with God. She went to many different churches and Bible studies, but she always appreciated when Christian and Nathan and I came over to her house to study. because she said the Bible felt really real to her. And she could understand it in a way that other people couldn't explain it to her. And the last study that we did was on Daniel 1 and 2 with her. And actually, Christian had some car trouble that day and couldn't make it. So Nathan went to go and help help him out. But during the last maybe half an hour, when I was just alone with her and her friend, she would actually bring a lot of friends with her to study. That was something that I appreciated a lot too as well. But during that last half hour with her, she just, she knew that God was real, that he was in her life, even though sometimes she didn't feel it. And I really believe that she was really striving to be right with God. Amen. In her own way. And just knowing that she was in the hospital the week after, and then just soon after that she passed away. And then later, Christian and I were talking about it. We know that she is going to be in heaven, because Amen. We have that assurance that she really wanted to be right with God. She really wanted to do her best, and she was really trying to surrender everything that she had, getting in the way between her and God. So just her life and her death is an amazing testimony to us. Every time we went over there, we walked away just very blessed and fulfilled by her ministry to us as well. So it was a very amazing opportunity to get to know her, to get to be with her in the last few months of her life.
Amen. Thank you so much, guys. The other comment that was made by these three was, what if we wouldn't have been out there in the community? What if we would not have been studying with people? And the other thing that Annalise said to me, or maybe it was her father telling me what she said to him, was, you know, you never know. You never know if the person you're talking to right now won't be there next week and won't have that opportunity. And how thankful we are that we're able to spend time with her. The academy was involved. You see, they kicked her a vegan meal. They washed all the cars out there as well. And a number of families have been involved over the last 3 or 4 years. I've been in her home a number of times as well. And we're so thankful that we could be there. We believe she was, the Lord was leading her. Now, this just update yesterday, we made two exciting visits this week with people that have decided to join the church, and then also those that have already joined. And we're excited about people, not just when they get baptized, but also after they're baptized. Amen. And we have a number of discipleship groups. But the one yesterday, which we'll come back to in the Divine Hour just as a reading, are Jenny and Richard, you see there with Narlin. Now, these two had planned to be baptized last week. They were in Narlin's TCI group. And as they planned to be baptized, just like the other lady who had kidney failure then died, Richard went into kidney failure. His fistula shut. They said that he was not a candidate to continue dialysis. He had a code blue. He had a massive bleed in his brain. And we rushed to the hospital just yesterday. And we went to the hospital, and I didn't realize about the bleed. And when I got there, I immediately went and got some anointing oil. And Richard was able to talk, and actually surprisingly well. And we talked with him, and he said, you know, I believe everything. I accept the Lord, and I want to be a part of his church. His wife, I believe, is going to be baptized today because he wants to see that baptism, even though he can't be. So she's going to be baptized today along with those who are recommitting their lives. And then go back and show that to her husband. And I'm just so thankful that God is moving. he knew about both of these people, and he knew they needed to make decisions, and he directed the right people at the right time. My time is up, but I'll take just 2 minutes, and where's Henry? I wanted to just say that there is another, quite a number of others that have made decisions, and we wanted to acknowledge that. So if you could call up this family as well.
Nilo and his family could come up, please.
So Nilo and his family, and what about Pastor Oleg, if he's here?
He's actually translating right now.
Okay, he's translating. Several years ago, the church here at Weimar donated some funds for Pastor Oleg to do canvassing work as he was attending the health program. And this is when he met Nilo and his family. Come over here, and I'll let Henry take it over here.
So Nilo and his family have been attending the church for a little over a year, and we'd just like to know how you came to know about the church. Ustedes han atendido a la iglesia un poco más de un año, y cómo es que ustedes vinieron a conocer de Weimar.
Oleg estaba pasando por la casa, estaba él vendiendo los libros de salud.
Oleg was came to the house, was selling books of health.
Pero antes de venderme los libros de salud, él sacó la Biblia y leyó la Biblia con nosotros.
But before selling the health book, Oleg read the Bible to them.
Entonces vi que ya poco me interesaba los libros, sino que más la Biblia. ¿Por qué me impactó? No sé. Dios lo sabe.
So he didn't realize, at first he liked the health books more, but then he realized he actually was more interested in the Bible, and he doesn't know exactly why. And God gave him a great desire for physical and spiritual health, and because of something that happened to him. And what was that?
Dios le dio un gran deseo por salud físico y espiritual. ¿Y cómo es que pasó eso? ¿Por qué pasó eso?
Antes de eso, yo hacía 3 semanas estaba pasando por un ataque al corazón, y el doctor dijo que era uno de los milagros más grandes que él había visto. Y pude reconocer que las palabras que Oleg dijo, que Dios sí me había guardado la vida.
He had a heart attack 3 weeks before Oleg had been there, and the doctor said that was one of the worst heart attacks he had ever seen, and that it's a miracle that he was alive today. And so then when Oleg came, he just realized that this was what he needed. And was God faithful to give you greater physical and spiritual health? ¿Ha sido fiel Dios de darte salud física y espiritual?
Absolutamente. Todo he sentido que Dios me ha recompensado grandemente.
Absolutely. He feels that God has truly rewarded him greatly. Thank you. We could say much more, but Olga, ¿has tenido qué te ha gustado o qué ha pasado en tu vida personal o en tu familia este último año? What has happened in your life this past year, Olga, personally or in your family?
En mi vida ha cambiado mucho porque en un principio que Oled nos visitó, nos leyó la Biblia, oró con nosotros y nos habló sobre los libros de la salud. Y como yo tenía una condición médica también que necesitaba hacer cambios en mi comida y todo eso, me gustó mucho y ya luego empezamos a venir a la iglesia. Y me encanta, todo me encanta porque es muy, muy bonito.
So she's just had an incredible experience. She has learned so much about health, and she even had some issues with her health. But God has tremendously blessed them spiritually and physically. And they love the church and everything they've learned. The children too, I know we're running out of time. The children, they have told me they love the Sabbath school. The two little ones here, Paula and Jonathan. And Jonathan especially, what is it, that one thing that you told me that one night, Wednesday night prayer meeting that you guys attend in Spanish? What did you say you did that day and you liked so much? You had?
TCI Kids.
TCI Kids. He loves TCI Kids. And Karina and Ariel, they are incredible Bible students. They love the Lord. They for many times have spent hours on the Sabbath studying the Bible and sharing about Christ. So they're very encouraging to me and inspirational. But they've made a decision. ¿Cuál es la decisión que han hecho ustedes?
Nosotros hemos decidido, tal vez el próximo mes vamos a dar un paso más de fe, vamos a bautizarlo, no estamos seguros si toda la familia, pero tres de nosotros estamos seguros bautizarnos, no sé qué pasará con nosotros.
So they've at least three of them have decided to be baptized next month, and that's what they've decided for, and that brings great joy to the Lord, all of heaven, and the Lord's heart. So praise the Lord. Gracias.
So the purpose of Adventist education is actually leading people to Christ and into the eternal kingdom. And I think it's important for those of you new in the church, that's the reason for this school. And it's also important for us to be reminded that this school works directly with a local church. And it's not always pretty, but it is glorious because people are being led out of darkness into light. And as they walk in the light, as He is in the light, they have fellowship one with another. Doesn't mean they're perfect, because the blood of Christ cleanses every sin as they walk in the light. I want to thank the Escamilla family as well. They've been leading the Spanish group here. And now there's, 10 to 12 people that are regular and even more. And God is blessing that, and Pastor Oleg as well. And all the students and staff that are working together to probably do the most lasting thing that we could do here, which is to point people to God's Word, which is everlasting, and people who accept it, who are also everlasting. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, thank you today for this brief time of study. We might be like Nicodemus, full of pride, coming in the middle of the night, and maybe have not yet fully decided to declare that we're recommitting to you in light of the Laodicean condition that we're in, and in light of the fact that we have left our first love. We thank you for the many who will rededicate their lives just after the church service today within the student body, and those that are newly going to come into the faith as well. But we all want to rededicate our lives today. And we thank you. We come in Christ's name. Amen.